Praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. You see, if we keep quiet, Jesus said, even these rocks will cry out praise to the Lord. So if you're living, if you're breathing tonight, with every fiber of your being, shout praises to God. He deserves all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. Well, good evening, everyone. Welcome to this week's edition of Thursday Night Bible Study. We are happy, we are glad, we are excited to have you with us here in person, and also to join us on Facebook Live. We'll later upload this video on our YouTube channel too. If you've never done before, I ask you that you subscribe to our YouTube channel, follow us on Facebook, so that you can receive more video like this. And together, let's share these messages and create a ripple effect that will take the gospel into all the world, so that others can hear the message and be blessed and be saved also. Well, thank you for joining us, and we've met here 3 weeks ago. For the last 2 weeks, we've been traveling, so we didn't came live online, but we are here back tonight live, and hopefully going forward we'll be here every week. So the last time we met, we've talked on your body, God's dwelling place. Tonight we continue on that message, part two. You've got your body, God's dwelling place, part two. Mm-hmm. So if you have your Bible, open with me to Genesis chapter 3, verse 16. Genesis 3:16. And as you are turning to Genesis 3:16, let's pray and let's ask the Lord for the blessing on His word. Father, we give you praise, we honor you, and we bless you, and we thank you, Lord, for bringing us here together, Lord, to sit together, open your everlasting, inerrant, infallible word, to hear from you. Your word, they are spirit and they are life. And as we open the word, we also open our hearts, our minds, our spirit, every arena of our lives to hear from you. We are hungry for your word. Fill us to overflow, Lord God, that we leave here different, Lord, that we leave word filled. We leave with something new that we have never known before. Deposit in us, minister unto us. Oh God, touch those who are here, those who will watch this video later or are watching now. Touch, heal, save, deliver, set free. In the name of Jesus, think through me, speak through me, Lord God. And I give you all the praise and honor and glory in Jesus' name. So as I mentioned, the last time we've met, we've talked on your body, God's dwelling place. And our body, the body that we live in, is referred to as the ark suit, the tent, tabernacle, jars of clay. And our body house and carry God's presence in the deep recesses of our spirit. And we've learned that according to 1 Corinthians 6:19, the verse said that your body is the temple. And we look at the word temple, it came from the Greek word naos. The temple or the naos or the sanctuary of the Holy Spirit who lives within you. Our God, He's an awesome, great, and mighty God. And He forever sits on His throne in heaven, and He watches over the earth. He rules over the earth. Everything that is happening in this world today may look like God is not in control, but He is in control. And at the right time, He will step in and come take His charge away, and things will change him. But He is in control. He's always in control. God is omniscient. He is omnipresent. He is omnipotent. The heavens of heavens cannot contain Him. Yet God humbled Himself and came to live in us, in and among us. We've started the study looking at four dwelling places of God in the earth. They are God first dwelt in Adam. God then dwelt in the tabernacle/temple. He then dwelt in Jesus. And number four, God now lives in the spirit of born-again man. We've completed number one the first time, the last time we've met. God first dwelt in Adam. And he was the first and original naos, temple of the living God. Tonight we'll continue on number 2, 3, 4. If we have the time, we'll go through all of them. So, I'll teach and read. Tonight I want to do something different. I'll teach and read from my book, Twice Born. If you didn't get a copy as yet, it's available on BarnesandNoble.com and Amazon.com. So I'll teach and read from my book, chapter 2. From my book, Twice Born, chapter 2, part of the chapter. We started part last week and another part we'll complete tonight if we have the time to go through it. So I'll be reading from my book. God first dwelt, as I mentioned, in Adam. He was a first, an original naos, dwelling place of God. But after he sinned in the garden, sin entered that first dwelling place, and it became defiled and desolate because God left. You see, sin always brings separation from God. When sin entered Adam and Eve, God's presence left. It became dark, and the light that they were covered with went out, and their eyes were open, and they tried to sew fig leaf suit and fig leaf gums to cover themselves. So when sin entered, the Spirit of God left. Sin always brings separation. But God didn't leave man in that sinful, fallen state, intending to once again dwell in man. He promised a Savior. In Genesis 3:16, God said, Genesis 3:16.
He said to the woman, I will increase your pain and your labor when you give birth to children, yet you will long for your husband, and he will roll you. 16. Then 17.
No, chapter 3, verse 16?
Yes.
Okay. And God said, there's another verse, God said, and I will put enmity between you and between the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. So, from the moment of the promise, God promised the woman of the seed to come to crush the enemy's head, God was looking for someone who he could trust to carry out his plan. In the Old Testament, God finally found a man by the name of Abraham and made an everlasting blood covenant with him, changing his name from Abram to Abraham. Abraham was now called a friend of God. And it would be through his bloodline that the promised Messiah would come. There was then a famine in the land. And God, to deliver his people from that famine, God raised up Joseph, and he prophesied, and he came up with a plan as to how to preserve the animals, preserve the people. So there was after a severe famine in the land, God appeared to Moses, and he called Moses to lead his people out of bondage from Israel, from Egypt. He also gave Moses the detailed instructions and measurements as to how to build the Ark of the Covenant, which represent the presence of God among his people. The Ark of the Covenant was first placed under a tent, a tabernacle, and then it was then placed in the temple that Solomon built. The temple made by hands now housed the Ark of the Covenant and became the second dwelling place of the presence of God on earth. But I want you to notice that the similarity. Adam was created how? He was created in the likeness and the image of God into a threefold being: spirit, soul, and body. The temple that housed the Ark of the Covenant was also made according to the instruction given to Moses, Solomon. The temple was also made in a three-part being also: the outer court, the inner court, and the innermost court. The innermost court was considered the most holy of holies. Where did God dwell in Adam? God dwelt in the innermost being, in the deep recesses of his spirit. God dwelt in the spirit of Adam. And where was God dwelling in the temple? He was also dwelling in the innermost court. The Ark of the Covenant was placed in the innermost court, in the most holy of holies. And that became the second dwelling place, God's second dwelling place on earth. That spot where the Ark of the Covenant was considered the most holiest spot on planet earth, because God's tangible manifested presence was there. Like the first man's, Adam's, spirit, body, fearfully and wonderfully made, designed, his spirit was made, designed, and overlaid with all the indescribable spiritual ornamentation and decorations to accommodate and hold God's presence. God also gave Moses the specific designs, instructions, and the materials to be used in making the Ark of the Covenant. The temple in which the Ark of the Covenant was placed was also elegantly, think about it, the temple Solomon built where the Ark was placed, the temple was also elegantly overlaid with gold, silver, bronze, silk, fine linen, and the finest of materials. The temple that Solomon built was the only of its kind in those days, and it was considered sacred and holy because God dwelt in that innermost part of the temple. But not long after, God's chosen people, who are a royal priesthood, a royal nation and a holy priesthood, turned away from the Lord and they followed after idols and sinned greatly against God. You see, sin always results in separation from God. So this ornate, beautifully designed, sacred and holy temple, after they sinned, the ornate, sacred, beautifully designed temple became defiled and desolate because God left. God's presence will always leave when there is sin present. So after the sin, in 585, I'll read from my book. Then in 585 BC, Nebuchadnezzar's army came and invaded Jerusalem, destroyed the temple, and carried away the Jews in captivity into Babylon. The temple walls were also rebuilt by Nehemiah. The rebuilt second temple was not in its original glory and splendor, but it was used by the Jews for sacrificing unto their God. After Herod the Great was given the position of king by the Romans, he expanded the Temple Mount and he rebuilt the second temple into a huge complex on the Temple Mount. Again, the people of God allowed sin to enter, and the temple became defiled and desolate. He said to them, Jesus said to them in Matthew 21:13, you see all these stones here? Not one stone will be left upon another. And he also told them that my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers. Sin entered that temple. They made it a den of robbers. God's presence left. God's presence departed from Adam. His body was destroyed. He died at the age of 930 years old, and his body returned to the dust. Sin entered the first temple. God's presence left, and Nebuchadnezzar's army invaded that and destroyed that temple, the first temple. The second temple was destroyed because of sin also in AD 70 by General Titus under Emperor Vespasian, who was General Titus' father. Today, on the Temple Mount, there stand a Muslim mosque, the Al-Aqsa Mosque, and the Dome of the Rock. But the Bible tells us that there will be a third temple that will be rebuilt in Jerusalem, probably on the Temple Mount. Yeah. But that will be rebuilt sometime before or during the time of the tribulation. And in the midpoint of the tribulation, the Antichrist will enter that temple and declare himself as God and command the people to worship him and to pay him homage. Jesus called this the abomination of desolation. Because of blasphemy and the abomination of desolation, sin again will cause the presence of God to depart. And that third temple even will be destroyed in the midpoint of the tribulation. That is exactly what we are seeing in our world today. Sin entered, the presence of God left. And I'll read from my book again. This is exactly what we are seeing happening around us today. Our nation brings destruction upon itself as its leaders reject God and the moral values of the Bible. Gun violence in our schools is more prevalent than ever since prayer was taken out of classrooms. Even our children are being taught evolution instead of creation. There's no wonder why the world is falling apart. It is all because the presence of God left, because we've sinned against Him. God's presence, God's second dwelling place on earth, was in the innermost court of the temple. It became defiled, desolate, and was finally destroyed because God left. As sin entered, sin always brings separation. So the first dwelling place of God was in Adam. The second dwelling place of God on earth was in the temple, which takes us to number three. God dwelt in Jesus. That's his third dwelling place. Adam was the first embodiment of God. He was followed by the temple, which also housed the presence of God on earth, the Ark of the Covenant. Both were defiled because became desolate and destroyed as a result of sin. But God, in his great love, compassion, and mercy, didn't give up on man, as he remembered the promise he made of sending the seed of the woman to crush the serpent's head. He kept his promise to Adam and to his friend and covenant partner, Abraham, by preparing a perfect dwelling place for himself. That perfect dwelling place was in Jesus, when Jesus walked the earth as man. This is the story of the incarnation. God the Son left heaven, came to earth as man, and was born of a virgin for the purpose of dying on a cross for the sin of the whole world. He then defeated sin, death, hell, and the grave, and rose again. And everyone who believes in, trusts in, and relies on him will be twice born. Jesus' body was miraculously made and formed in the womb of the Virgin Mary by the power of the Holy Spirit. That sinless, holy, pure, and sacred body became the third and perfect dwelling place of God on earth. Hebrews 10:5. Hence, when he, Christ, entered into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offering you have not desired, but instead you have made ready a body for me to offer." In the Genesis of creation, God scooped down. God reached down, scooped a handful of dust from the earth, shaped it, formed it, fashioned it, and molded it into Adam's body. It was earthly. It was made from the earth. The body of Jesus was not formed from the dust of the earth, but the body of Jesus was formed from above by the power of the Holy Spirit. It was heavenly from above. Adam's body was from the earth. Jesus' body was formed in Mary's womb by the Holy Spirit from above. It was heavenly, not earthly. Notice the trend. God first fashioned and designed Adam's body. God also gave Moses the design and the measurement of the Ark of the Covenant and the temple. Here again, the Holy Spirit was the one who designed, formed, and fashioned the body of Jesus in Mary's womb. Jesus, who was, who is, and forever will be God, took upon himself flesh and was born in Bethlehem's manger. Bethlehem was not his beginning. It was at Bethlehem that God manifested himself to the world as man. Hebrews 1:13 tells us, "He is the sole expression of the glory of God, the light being the outraying or radiance of the divine, and he is the perfect imprint and very image of God's nature, upholding and maintaining and guiding and propelling the universe by his mighty word of power. When he had, by offering himself, accomplished our cleansing of sin and riddance of guilt, sat down at the right hand of the divine majesty on high." He was God and is God before, God forever. Bethlehem is not his beginning. He was there, existing forever and ever and ever in the eternity past. The story tells of a wealthy king dressed in his royal robe, coronated with his golden and glorious crown, filled with dazzling stones, and sitting on his huge gilded throne in a palace made of all kinds of precious stones, mosaics, and lavishly decorated marbles. The king stands and looks through his inlaid golden palace window into the muddy and sandy streets overrun by the common people and beggars who struggle to earn their next meal. His heart was touched and moved with a deep compassion for the villagers as he greatly desired to be with them. But he couldn't because of his royal highness as king over all the land. So he took off his crown, his royal robe, and his jewelry and rings, and he wrapped himself in a beggar's coat and sprinkled dust over his skin that was well preserved with the best of spices and oil. The wealthy king, disguised as a beggar, stepped out of his mosaic floor and stepped into the muddy trail and lived a while among the poor, the unfortunate, the homeless, the outcasts, the orphans, the prostitutes, and the rejected, loving them and helping them out of their poverty. He showed them how to start a new beginning and to have a new life by teaching them how to read and write and be smart and successful. This is the story of the incarnation. God the Son left his glorious throne and splendor, abandoning his sovereign possession, emptied himself of his glory, wrapped himself in human flesh, and came to dwell among us, showing us the way to eternal life. Jesus' body of human flesh, an external appearance, was like any other man. Our Lord didn't walk around with a halo around his head like Adam, with a light covering his body. Jesus didn't scale the hills of Jerusalem and Galilee and Bethlehem and shoot rays of lightning from his eyes or from his fingers. He came as a man and lived humbly as a man. He was fully God and fully man. He lived a sinless life among sinful people. That's why, as twice born children of God, we can live in a sin-infested world and represent Jesus as he represented his Father. Jesus fulfilled and met all the requirements of the 630 commandments given to Moses. Centuries earlier, it was Jesus in his pre-incarnate existence appeared to Moses and gave him all those commandments which even Moses or any other person on earth could ever live up to and obey. Jesus came and lived up to them all. His body was the perfect dwelling place of God on earth as he walked the earth. The high priest, the Pharisees, the temple guards, the Roman soldiers, and Jesus' betrayer, Judas, arrested Jesus, had him so brutally beaten that his appearance was beyond recognition, as the Old Testament prophets foresaw centuries before. Isaiah 52:14. For many, the servants of God became an object of horror. Many were astonished at him. His face and his whole appearance were marred more than that of any man, and his form beyond that of the sons of men. He was then nailed to a cross, bearing all our sins, past, present, and future, upon himself. All the curses that will ever come upon mankind, he took upon himself. All evil and every diabolical and sinister thing that will ever be unleashed from hell and come upon this planet was placed upon Jesus on the cross. As Jesus became sin for us and hung there on the cross between heaven and earth, God's perfect dwelling place became defiled, desolate, and destroyed, as had God's previous dwelling place. Adam's spirit and the temple of God in the Old Testament. Why? Again, because sin always brings separation and destroys everything it touches. Jesus never sinned. He lived perfectly, the only perfect person who has ever lived. It is our sin upon him that brings separation, defilement, desolation, and destruction. Nicodemus, who came in John chapter 3 by night to question Jesus of being born again, back then recognized Jesus as teacher and rabbi. But here, when Jesus gave his life on the cross for the sin of the world, Nicodemus didn't came there as rabbi as and seeing Jesus as rabbi. He came knowing that Jesus is the Son of God, the Master, the Messiah, the one who was to come. And he came and with Joseph of Arimathea to bury the body of Jesus. They laid the body of Jesus in a tomb. His spirit descended to the lowest part of hell, where no man has ever been, taking all the sin, curse, and darkness. He took upon himself and suffered the punishment there in our place. But on the third day, he rose from the dead. The grave could not hold him. The prison bar could not imprison him. Hell's chain could not chain him. Jesus broke those chains, tore those bars apart, conquered death, hell, and the grave, and rose triumphantly from the dead. The body that was defiled, desolate, and destroyed because of sin, or so Satan and his cohorts thought, now became pure, bright, and a glorified, resurrected body. Jesus is still fully God and fully man. There is a man in the Godhead, and his name is Jesus. Jesus told the religious people of his day in John 2:19, destroy, undo this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up again. He was talking about his body, pointing to his body. He told the religious people, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up again. The body of Adam was destroyed and returned to the ground, to the earth from which it was formed. The previous temple that housed the Ark of the Covenant of God was destroyed and left in ruins, returning to the earth from which it was also made. But notice this, God's perfect dwelling place, Jesus says, body is indestructible and victoriously rose from the dead as a glorified body. Why so? That's because Adam's body and the temple were made of earthly materials. Jesus' body was heavenly. He wasn't formed from the dust of the earth. He wasn't from earth. God is his Father, and his body was supernaturally and miraculously formed from above in Mary's womb. Because Jesus became the firstborn from the dead with a glorified, resurrected body, our bodies can now be God's permanent dwelling place here on earth once we become twice born. So the first dwelling place of God on earth was in Adam, the second in the temple, the third in Jesus as he walked the earth. Number four, God's permanent dwelling place is in born again man. God the Son left his throne in eternity, traveled through the unseen realm, through time and space, came to earth with a mission to free the human race from the clutches of sin. He completed his divine assignment, accomplished God's will, and rose again to life, and is now the mediator between God and man. Jesus stands in the gap between God and man, holding the hand of God and the hand of man. The hand that is holding us is lifting us up to himself and to the Father. Every breathing person who received Jesus as Lord and Savior become every breathing person who received Jesus as Lord and Savior becomes born again from above, or twice born. At the moment of the new birth, God the Holy Spirit makes an entrance into the spirit of that person, recreating and redesigning his or her spirit anew, fresh, sparkling, and splendorous, so that he or she now becomes the temple, the naos of the Holy Spirit. As the Bible says in Ephesians 2:1, and you he made alive when you were dead, slain by your trespasses and sin. Before the renewing and recreation of the reborn spirit, our spiritual state was dead, physically living, breathing, and talking, but spiritually dead and separated from God. But thanks be to God, he did not leave mankind in that horrible place of spiritual death like zombies. As a result of his great love, he remedied that situation of banishment by laying down his own life so that we might have life, eternal life in him. And the Bible goes on to say in Ephesians 2:2, in which at one time you walked habitually, you were following the course and fashion of this world, were under the sway of the tendency of this present age, following the prince of the power of the air. You were obedient to and under the control of the demon spirit that still constantly works in the sons of disobedience, the careless, the rebellious, and the unbelieving, who go against the purposes of God. This verse reminds us of our way of living before surrendering to the Lordship of Christ, the time when we habitually walk and live in sin. Before Christ in our lives, we were following the prince of the power of the air and were controlled and dominated by a strong demonic force that formed a stronghold in our minds. Our minds were so bombarded by the fleshly desires that we have been trapped and entangled in a web spun by the devil, and we have become hungry for drinks, for smokes, pornography, murder, abortion, sex out of marriage, lies, deceit, covetousness, and so on. We crave for the things of society, its fashion and way of doing things. We wish we could live like celebrities, even comparing our spouse with someone else's, wishing that they can be like them. We seek to have faster cars, bigger houses, larger incomes. Like mountaineers, we strive to the top as fast as we can, yet we still find emptiness and remain unfulfilled when we've arrived. That dark, sinister force that controls and dominates our mind then is from the devil. Tirelessly working behind the scenes in society, politicians, governments, leaders, in the world's economy and in the world's system is the devil, with the only purpose to kill, to steal, and to destroy. He has no power and authority over creation or the universe. He only has power over the world's system of operation, which was given to him by Adam in Eden's garden. That is why he is called the prince of the power of the air. The devil works through the courts, governments, government officials, religion, atheists, education system, and social media, the entertainment industry, internet, television, AI, and will soon work through the Antichrist to deify himself during the time of the tribulation. He will work through the world's system then to establish a one-world government, a one-world religion, a one-world monetary system, and a one-world leader, who is the Antichrist. It is no wonder why we are seeing these signs today in our world, because future events seem to cast a shadow before it happens. What we are seeing here is what will happen in the future during the time of the tribulation. That is the reason why it is very important and crucial for us as twice born children of God to pray for our country, pray for our leaders, pray for our schools and communities. I must note also that there are many God-fearing Christians working in these positions. Let's pray for their protection and pray too that they shine forth as light in this dark world, wherever they are. So many in the world today hate God and the Bible because the enemy is working behind the scenes in this world system, creating an environment filled with the children of disobedience. That is the spiritual condition and the state of mind we were all in before being twice born. But somewhere, sometime, and somehow, God opened our eyes and our ears, and we heard the word preached. And as we yielded and submitted our spirit to God, conception occurred, and eternal life was implanted in our spirit. And so we became twice born. When that happens, when you become twice born, your body, my body, and the bodies of every born again child of God is now the permanent dwelling place of God on this planet. God designed Adam's body. Much later, under the instruction and guidance of God, the tabernacle that housed the Ark of the Covenant of God was designed. God designed Jesus' body at the incarnation. And finally, God designed our spirit and made it so magnificently opulent that he now lives in our bodies. We are now a walking, talking, breathing, and living sanctuary of God. The heavens of heavens cannot contain God, yet he made us into the temple where he now abides. We are carriers of his glory. We are the embodiment of Christ. Greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world. My friend, sickness and disease has no right to be in your body, because your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. If you are sick today, if you have an ailment or infirmity in your body, in the name of Jesus, I say it and I speak healing into your body, into your life, because your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit in which God lives. Knowing that our body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, we should make it a daily habit to confess and speak God's word over our life. We should say and declare constantly that Christ in me, the hope of glory. There is therefore now no condemnation in me, because Christ lives in me. Though I live, yet not me, but Christ lives in me. And the life I live in this body, I live by faith of the Son of God, who loves me and gave himself for me. You can find those in Colossians 1:27, Romans 8:1, Colossians 2, Galatians 2:20. Under the old covenant, God had a temple for his people. But under the new covenant, God has his people for his temple. The body of a twice born is the royal residence of God, the naos, the sanctuary of God. Don't let the devil or anyone talk you out of that. You are the embodiment of Christ. If you are born again, then your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. And what's more, Jesus ascended into heaven, and he prepared and made ready mansions in heaven for you. Nothing existing on this earth can be compared to your spiritual interior and the heavenly mansions that await you in heaven. When you go to church, and you should be going to church, you are not going into the presence of God. No, you are carrying the presence of God with you to church, because he lives on the inside of you. Just think about the unlimited power of God that is released when believers assemble together in unity. Hundreds or thousands of twice-born believers filled with the presence of God under one roof. I'm telling you, something miraculous will happen and change in the realm of the Spirit. A big explosion of the power of God that causes the devil and his bunch to flee. That is why people get healed, saved, delivered, and made free, and receive many miracles in church meetings and church conferences. My friend, 100 years from now, the most magnificent cathedral and church, lavishly embellished with all kinds of ornamentations and decorations, may not be in existence. But your created, renewed, and reborn spirit that is living in your body right now will be alive in a glorified heavenly body, living in a mansion and forever enjoying the presence of God. Do you not know that your body is a temple, the sanctuary of the Holy Spirit who lives in you, whom you have received as a gift from God? You are not your own. I did a lot of reading tonight. I read, and I tried to exhort, I read an excerpt from part of chapter 2 of my book, Twice Born. You can get my book and read the entire book for yourself. You'll be blessed. But now that you know the four dwelling places of God on earth, Adam, the tabernacle in Jesus, and now permanently in us, what are we to do? Well, 1 Corinthians 6:20 tells us what to do. It says, you were bought with a price. You were purchased with a preciousness and paid for, made his own. So then, 1 Corinthians 6:20 tells us, so then, honor God and bring glory to him in your body. God is now living on the inside of you, if you are born again. Honor God in your body. The next time you think about lighting, striking that match and lighting a cigarette, remember, you're defiling the body, the temple of the Holy Spirit. The next time you think about going to sleep around or to go to the bar, think about you are defiling God's dwelling place. Honor God in your body. 1 Corinthians 6:20 tells us. Is either you are the embodiment of Christ or you are the carrier of the dark, sinister force of the devil. You're either one. You carry God or you carry the devil. If you are born again, well, thank God that you accept Him and know you are the embodiment of Christ. But if you are not born again, I pray that you be filled with the Holy Spirit and that you become the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives within you. When Adam sinned in the beginning, in the Genesis of creation, God tell him, the day that you eat of that fruit, of that tree, you will surely die. When they eat that fruit, did they fall immediately to the ground and die? Adam lived to 930 years old. They didn't die immediately in their body, but they died immediately in their spirit. Their spirit became separated from God. Adam was made a threefold being, spirit, soul, and body. When they sinned, they died instantly in their spirit, and then they died slowly in their soul, and finally in their body. And look at the reverse. When you become born again, we live and have eternal life instantly in the spirit. And then God slowly sanctify us and teach our soul and preserve our soul. And then finally, we will live forever in a glorified body. Pray the Spirit me to live permanently in a glorified body, carrying the presence of God in you. If you never received Jesus as Lord and Savior, I give you the opportunity to receive Jesus as Lord and Savior, to become the embodiment of Christ, the carrier of His glory. Father, thank you for your word. I pray, God, and I ask you to forgive me of all sin, and I confess that Jesus is Lord, and I believe in my heart He is risen from the dead. Save me, Lord. Take my life and do something with it that will bring glory and honor in your name. Lord, teach me your way. Teach me to pray. Teach me to read the Bible. Lead me to go to a church where I be taught the word and grow with other believers in my faith walk with you. Live big on the inside of me. Shine through me, Lord, that others see you in me. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, if you pray that prayer, you're now born again, saved, and you are now the embodiment of Christ. Your body is now the temple of the Holy Spirit. Join us again next Thursday for another study. And until then, remember, God loves you. We love you. And be blessed. Be empowered to prosper and excel in every areas of our life, spirit, soul, body, financially, and socially. In Jesus' name, bye-bye. See you again.